Gentlemen, thanks for that, and welcome at the Naturkunde Museum Berlin. Welcome to Glitzern Denken, the science variety show that tries to entertain your souls and your brain. We say welcome also to our guests online in front of the TV or screen or whatever. It's great that you joined us. Hello, and you can ask us questions in the chat, and also the people here, if you have a question, ask them, ask it, we try to answer it.
If you're brave enough.
If we are brave enough, yes, or if we feel the competence. If not, we would answer it on our blog, we promise
them. Love the blog.
Yes, okay, but now, maybe, first, I introduce myself, okay? And then I introduce you, what do you think about that?
Sounds lovely.
Let's do that. My name is Ines Theileis, I'm a singer, and I'm the host for this evening. I'm very happy to welcome all of you here. And, you know, for an event like this, you do not come alone. Come on. I have a plus one. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with me the beautiful dancer and hula hoop artist, Philip Goller. Yeah. You look great today. Amazing.
You too. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine. And how are you? Mm.
Enough of this.
Let's talk about something serious for tonight, you know?
All right.
Better than just small talk. We can do that later. So our subject for tonight is that a natural history museum is kind of a paradox because, you know, on the one hand, the museum wants to explain and want to tell the story of life. How does life work? And then they collect dead animals. How does that work out? How do you do that? We would like to figure that out, but not just Philip and me. No worries, you know, you come to the museum for once and then just the two of us talking. No, we have here an amazing professor here from the museum, Professor Dr. Johannes Müller. Ladies and gentlemen, please give him a warm welcome. It's great to have you here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here tonight.
Yes, great. It's an honor for us. It's a pleasure for you. Great. You are a professor for paleozoology, also at the Humboldt University, and you do research, evolution, and diversification in reptiles, right?
Basically, I study lizards, snakes, and turtles, and be happy about that.
Okay. Yeah. And the fossil ones and the recent ones?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Officially, I'm a paleontologist, so I study extinct and fossil lizards, turtles, and snakes.
Yes.
And sometimes also mammals and other things. But I would say half of my time I also devote to like living animals.
That's good.
Like
you should
lizards,
all, always, you yeah. know, devote some of your time to yeah. living animals. I really recommend that, I think. We will learn about these things tonight. I'm very excited. The two of us will speak about three subjects. One is we want to define life and death scientifically. Let's see whether we figure that out. Then we would like to see how you tell life with dead objects. How does that work out here at the museum? We'll see. And the third is we want to learn what dead objects can tell us about life. And this is, again, I mean, we speak about what you figured out with all the fossils and the maybe dead animals.
I'll try my best.
You did the last 2 days already, okay. And I'm very, very convinced that this will be great. That's this, and I think this is the point where I give the space to you, and you explain for us our checklist life, if I may ask.
Okay.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Well,
Professor Johannes.
Thank you again, and good evening, everyone. we have this presentation here. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
For many centuries, probably millennia, people have been thinking about what life is. And there have been many, many different ideas about it. And if you go through the history of mankind, there's all kinds of different propositions and hypotheses about what life actually should be and mm-hmm. what makes life in the first place and so on. Nowadays, I think we can kind of like agree on a combination of the following six criteria, which we have listed here.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
And the first one is energy exchange and metabolism. So I think we all have some sort of a metabolism.
Mm-hmm.
Some people a bit, I don't know, high level, others a bit on a low level. But in principle, we all have that, right? So second, organization and self-regulation.
Mm.
Yeah, not sure about that either. So,
I think I'm dead.
Sometimes. Yeah.
But we can find out about that via the third criterion, response to stimuli. So if
we can really respond well.
Definitely, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right.
This is what we can do.
The fourth criterion is reproduction and heredity. So we want to have, I don't know, offspring or official children, for example, and
mm-hmm.
I don't know, transfer our genes to the next generation and so on. And this is also something that at least here, and we're talking about life on Earth. I mean, we could have a discussion about life in the universe, but I guess we're not going.
No, today not, because,
right?
You know, we cannot.
Yes, I would love to do this, but.
Yeah, another time we do that,
okay.
Another time.
The fifth criterion is growth.
It hurts.
Growth hurts, yeah.
Yes.
It hurts to grow, you know.
Yeah, could be all kinds of growth, but again, we're not.
Again, for another day. Okay, let's go on. Let's concentrate, let's focus
I'm
here.
I'm trying so hard.
The sixth one is adaptation.
Yes.
Or actually evolution. So something is changing. Well, an individual can adapt to certain things and over time things evolve. And that's basically also, that kind of like makes all these things together, I have to say, are necessary to say something is alive. I mean, you will also find individual examples elsewhere, you know, where something is growing but not alive, or something is organized but not alive, But if all these criteria apply, then we would say something is alive.
Okay, cool. That's the checklist. So what's with the checklist death?
That's way easier.
Yeah? Oh, that's great.
Because there's actually just one criterion here, and it must have been alive, right? So basically a rock, depending on what kind of rock,
yes,
but like some sort of a volcanic rock, has never been alive, so it's not dead.
I mean, okay.
That chair here, it's wood.
It was alive.
Yeah,
I thought so too.
That is dead to some extent, depending on what is all in that chair, but yeah.
So it's the first time something is actually simple here at the museum. So nice.
Yeah, it's great. So at the end, we figured out one simple definition. That's amazing. Let's see whether that definition works all the time.
Magnets move. Thales said that magnets move.
And that's that's why they are alive. That's what he said.
Of course.
Yeah.
Amber too, no?
Well, Aristotle said that Thales said that magnets are alive. They are not, right?
No. Magnetism is something else. Yeah, but that's one of those ideas, like I said earlier, people have been thinking about this for a long time.
And yes.
What life is, you know? Mm-hmm. And some people came up with magnetism or electricity, but usually most organisms aren't magnetic. I mean, mm-hmm. there is some sort of magnetism somewhere, but again, we're not going there.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you.
And electricity, also, like plants aren't electric in any kind of sense. We are.
Yesterday
so
in the chat, someone gave an example for one plant that's electric.
Plant?
But we would like, I don't remember, we can check the chat.
Yeah. I don't like that person.
You know? No. But no, I think it's just, you know, but the difference is it's just one plant that has something
I don't remember the plant. Okay.
Maybe Bonnie or someone else can figure it out and we can give you the information that we can get back to focus, but it was just one plant, and there are a lot of plants that don't have electricity.
Exactly, so everybody has to be electric if electricity was supposed to be a criterion for being alive.
I sing the body electric.
Ooh, that's right. Okay.
She's an English poem quote. Hey. Okay, let's go on, okay?
All right.
So we already did that. That's amazing.
It's time for music then?
Yeah, I think so. But before, I would like to say one thing. There is a Persian poet and thinker. He's very famous. He's called Rumi. And he said, without death, you take away the chance for evolution for any being in the world. How right he was. We will figure that out. But now, ladies and gentlemen, the Babylon Orchestra with Fra El Dunye.
Thank you.
the Babylon Orchestra. And I need to apologize. I forgot to introduce you. How could I? How could I? Ladies and gentlemen, it's a huge honor to have this incredible ensemble here. For everyone to know, this ensemble plays everywhere right now in Germany, and I think they deserve it. They are very modern, very interesting. All the instrumentalists you see here are soloists. They are really, really very good on their instruments. It's an honor to have you here. Thank you for that. And thank you for Freie Donje. Thank you. Okay. Then maybe we do just give you one applause for the orchestra because you really deserve it. Yes. Thank you. Okay. How could I forget to introduce the musicians? So let's go back to our checklist. Do you would like to come to here to the center?
Let's see.
You know, okay. And we start with something you might know about, but I don't. But still, I will explain it because we would like to check, you know, this life checklist whether it works out for different levels of biology. So I called the Max Delbrück Zentrum. They are around the corner. It's the Center for Molecular Biology Research, and they're very cool. And I met there with Agnieszka Rybak-Wolf, and she is the head of the organoid platform, and that's a very interesting subject, organoids. It's like mini organs.
Really cute.
They're really cute. They grow them. So they can grow a liver, and they can grow a heart and a brain and your intestines and whatever. So and then they can put it on a chip, and then they can see if it runs through the system, what does it do with your brain, the medicament. How do you say the drug? Drug is the English word.
Drugs or medication.
Medication. So you can't. So this is the future of drug testing, of the testing how drugs work on human beings. Really individual and without any animals are harmed. So that's amazing. That is done around the corner and it's really great. So yeah, this is what they look like. These are brain organoids. Agnieszka Rybak-Wolf works with brain organoids, she explained to me. And so they are very tiny. Can you see that? They are really, really tiny. So let's go one further. Let's see the checklist, whether they are alive. I mean, they are organs, maybe it's, I don't know what it is. So. She said, energy exchange and metabolism, yeah. Even Christmas, they need to feed them. They need to come in and feed them all the time.
So what do they eat?
We love that question.
We love it. We have always questions about molecular biology that I need to answer. No. But okay, this time we have someone here. We have Luisa Bengtsson here, and she works also with the with the Max Delbrück Zentrum. Luisa, would you please take that question with you and maybe later answer it on the blog with us? That would be great. You know some people who know stuff that we don't. So yeah, what we want, we would like to know, what do they eat? Yesterday we had the question. Do they have names?
And how often they eat?
How often they eat? What do they eat? And do they have? Do you name them? We would like to know that. Yes. And we put the answers on the blog.
Can I yes? Not just a number or something. Do you really give them names?
Yeah.
I mean, like a real name, like Brainy or something. Brainy 1, 2. Okay.
Or Pinky. Pinky and the Brain.
Ooh, Pinky and the Brain. That actually would be nice. It could be different organoid. You know, it could be some sort of a little, I don't know, heart that is a little pinkish.
Yes.
And then you have the brain.
Okay.
And then you have
Do you remember the thing
different
with
petri
the
dishes with like different organoids, and then one is pink, one
I'm
is
not
the
talking
brain.
With you anymore. Honestly.
We had some ideas about that, okay? No. And if you look for some names, the two of us could bring some up. Yeah? Just give us a note. Thank you. Okay, organization and self-regulation. Yeah, it seems like they can do that. That's amazing. Then response to stimuli. Yeah, they can. How did they find that out? Agnieszka honestly explained to me that someone, you know, took a little piece of wood and hit them. They hit the organoids. I mean, not badly, but they tried and they reacted not amused.
Well, that would be another question. How did they react?
We give you the questions later. But yeah, how do they react? And you had another question. How would they react on citron?
Oh, like if you eat an oyster, which I don't, but I mean, people do that. Take a lemon or something, and then you squeeze the lemon, and then the oyster reacts.
So,
so that's
So the professor from the Naturkunde Museum would like to know what happens if you put a citron on an organoid, and we ask here officially the Max Delbrück Center to answer this question. Thank you for that.
I mean, somehow they must have seen the reactions when you say response stimuli. Somehow do they?
But we cannot answer it tonight.
Okay, all right.
I'm so sorry, Johannes.
All kinds of interesting questions.
Yeah, I know. So. But we have it in the right place, this question. Thank you, Lisa. Okay, then. Growth, yes, they grow, absolutely. Adaption, well, but how can you adapt in a petri dish? I mean, what is that?
So small.
Yeah, but that means they are not alive. Within our definition, they are not alive. And we said, if you are not alive, you cannot die, right? You said that.
This is what I said.
Yeah. Click. Agnieszka, send me a picture of a dead organoid. This is a dying organoid. This is a dying, sad, dying organoid.
Too much
saying its last will?
Maybe, so, maybe.
That is another question. not the last will, but the question is, yeah. How do they die? What, because you don't feed them anymore?
No, I think
or
they
how
do
long
age.
Would they live?
Too much
they
drugs.
Age? They do age. I think I remember they age. I thought about that question yesterday, I think, but it's better that you answer that question
then
later.
Next question, what would be their life expectancy?
you know what? We would like to speak about the subjects of this house.
Okay.
Yesterday shy, today outgoing.
And we will invite you when we speak about this.
All right.
There we
all
go.
Okay. Oh, incredible. Okay. So, well, it's not alive, but it can die. Why? Because it's artificial, right?
Well, that's kind of like our interpretation here. This is still it's we're using the tools of life on Earth,
yes.
But at the same time, it's an artificial thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, at least, therefore, our criteria that we have for life otherwise mm-hmm. don't really apply here because we're kind of like not playing according to the rules.
So
this is what I would personally say, but it's of course a matter of discussion. Would actually probably like. Fill an entire evening thinking about this.
Don't do that tonight. But so you see, a definition is a delicate thing. You put a definition in a different context, it breaks. All the time in science. We need to know that. So a definition that works in everyday life doesn't work in mathematics or whatever. So and also with biology, you need to check in what frame you use your definition, right?
Question?
Where?
I have a question.
You have a question. Please read that to us.
Which animals have the longest lifespan and why? What is nature's recipe for a long life?
Do you also have a normal voice to read?
This is the voice from the person that asked the question.
Thank you for this beautiful question. Actually, I think we have a great answer to that. And with the next point, we just want to skip to the next question. I think we answer this question with that.
Right?
At least to some extent we do.
Yeah.
I know you
can. So. Now we speak about something you know about, flatworms.
Exactly, because I'm the world-renowned flatworm expert. but still, flatworms.
Well, yes.
Some of you know flatworms because the tapeworm also belongs to flatworms, which is probably not very pleasant if you have the tapeworm. But flatworms are a very, very diverse group.
Yes.
And some of them, the so-called planarians, are special in the sense that they do not age and their cells do not basically deteriorate over time, or their bodies do not deteriorate over time. So everybody, all multicellular life otherwise, has some sort of a programmed death. So sooner or later, you just, you know, go downhill. But these planarians, not all of the flatworms, you know, but these planarians, they seem to regenerate properly, or they don't seem to basically have any problems.
With aging.
So technically with aging. I don't know if they have other problems, or maybe they don't have any problems at all. Who knows? You know?
Maybe that's the goal, become a flatworm. Next life, become a flatworm.
And so technically they are immortal from that perspective.
Yeah, okay.
But going back to the question.
Yes.
Ooh.
I think immortal means living very long.
Exactly, but I think the question was, lifespan. What about lifespan? That is a different story.
Well,
depends on how you think about lifespan.
Yeah, now we are back there, but depends on how you define
life. Yeah, so, I mean, there are certain animals that really can, like, live for centuries, even among vertebrates. I mean, some tortoises
can
get very old. Some trees, of course, are really old, thousands and thousands of years. And then, of course, if you go into
the sea?
I thought about it. Bacteria and stuff like this.
Bacteria,
and so
yes.
there are certain bacteria that technically also like live forever, or that, or some of them could be even some fossil bacteria that somehow could be revived to some extent, you know,
what?
Because they were like already technically they were dead or something like this, I mean maybe not really, for a long, long time, and then they were basically they could make them reproduce again.
No.
So then the question really becomes like, what is really like the longest lifespan that you have? But otherwise, I would say like when we're talking about more like higher life, you know, it's probably in the maximum is somewhere in the millennia, you know.
Okay.
And I would say it's probably all, well, it's not vertebrates at least, you know, that can grow that old.
No.
Some plants, maybe some other animals.
But it was a great question.
Yeah.
Thank you for this great question. Thank you for that. And let's check so the flatworms don't age. Beautiful for them.
So the planarians, there will be an anti-aging.
The planarians, thing. Just the planarians.
Yeah. The tapeworm is a different story.
That's good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nothing against that.
They're in their own bubble today. No chance.
What do you?
What is about my anti-aging cream?
Do I get one
with worms inside?
Yeah, planaria. Great name.
Yeah.
Planaria.
Yeah.
So would that work? I mean, you said that they really do research about that, right?
Oh yes, of course. And because they do not age or don't seem to need any types of, I don't know, well,
creams.
They regenerate so well that there's a lot of research on them because, of course, industry, whatever, humans, many people are interested in anti-aging. And, of course, there's a lot of money in that.
Can you imagine to have a flatworm cream? Or planaria cream?
Well, think about it. There's so many other things already in stuff that
actually
use.
We kind soaps. Of, I remember we had a snail slime soap here in this show some years ago. It was very delicious as well.
Did you eat it?
No, but I can give you, have one left.
I
didn't even wash myself about it. But whatever. That's another story. So, but it is alive, right?
Yes, because these are all the criteria that also apply to flatworms.
Yes, so they are alive.
And even the planarians that technically are kind of immortal in some sense, they're, no matter what, they are alive.
So that also means just because you can't die doesn't mean you're not alive. Also very important. So, let's go on. Zoology. I mean, your subject, your profession.
I don't.
Well, flatworms are also part of zoology to some extent, you know,
okay.
But yes.
Okay.
It's zoology, as you all know, it's like animal research.
Well, as far as I know, there don't even exist worms, so it's interesting.
Well, that's also the. Okay,
that's a different thing. We don't go there. So, but let's go to the zoology.
Click.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, fellas.
Yeah. Here is essentially a repetition of what you just saw for the flatworms. I mean, all animal life is, as the name already implies, life.
Yes.
So they are certainly alive, and all those criteria apply.
That we
to
don't
them.
Have to go through.
We also are part of it, and we are also.
We do
all
these
criteria.
Things, maybe not organization and self-regulation,
but
the rest
we do.
Yeah,
it really depends on the mood, but otherwise, yes.
Can't do that always, but let's go on. Yes. Let's go a little bit abstract, you know, because one of the things I learned here at the Museum für Naturkunde is we need to change our attitude towards nature, how we see ourselves within nature. So let's maybe check whether ecosystems in this definition are alive.
Yeah, well, we can take a look at the checklist.
Yes.
And, I just first take all the positive criteria.
Always go for the positive first, I learned.
So certainly ecosystems have some sort of a metabolism or energy exchange.
I mean,
like cycles and like carbon cycles and stuff like this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, ecosystems have that. They also are organized and in some way, they have some sort of self-regulation. I mean, when you see that quite nicely when you go into similar climate zones in different areas of the world where you find the same types of ecosystems, but they independently evolved.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so from that perspective, this also applies to them. And like I just said evolved, that essentially means they also adapt.
Mm-hmm.
So criteria number 6 also applies. They certainly also grow if they have the chance to.
Mm-hmm.
And they respond to stimuli, of course, sometimes for the good, sometimes for the worse. Depending on what you do to them, what kind of stimuli you apply.
I feel we did some things to them. Some of them are not really pleased with us.
That's right. They're quite sensitive at the same time, even though they're not alive. You know, they're a bit. Sensitive.
You think an ecosystem is a kind of a diva, or?
In some way, they are. You know, they should not like always exaggerate, right?
Yeah, but really we also did not treat them well. We did not treat them well.
But they don't reproduce. There's no baby ecosystems. No date with between two ecosystems.
It would be so funny. Ecosystem Tinder.
Yeah. He says that to me because I always ask about my baby.
Yeah. Baby, because you want to have a big baby ecosystem.
He already knows that I'm going to ask that, so he's like, no, you don't get it today. Okay.
From that perspective, they're not alive. So that's like, so no, we have to say ecosystems, although they're getting close,
but
they're not alive.
And that's a no for you.
That's a no, even though it feels alive. Weird. Okay, you want to see once more, last time, how to make a joke with a...
They love it here.
If a biologist, you know.
Species. Ah, no comment.
You know, just for the people who are not biologists, biologists have opinions about discussions about species. Yeah, some like it, most don't like it.
I don't.
Really? No. I didn't thought that. Really?
I like ecosystems more.
That's fine for me. I think they are more important for our survival than our understanding of species. But thank you, Johannes Müller. For that, thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, it's time for music again. Please have fun with me and with us, with Avlidi Vlidi, with the Babylon Orchestra and Alla Sweeten. Thank you. Yeah, great. Thank you. So, you and me, we... Yeah, come on. Come to the center again. Thank you. We already spoke about the definitions and checked them. Now let's speak about preparation. Because this is something that needs to be done if you want to do research in a house like this, right?
Yes. I mean, there's all kinds of preparation here, but essentially what we're doing is we're trying to document and archive life on Earth. Mm-hmm. And for that, we prepare organisms in various ways.
And what I think is fascinating, it's not like, you know, okay, here's a dead animal and now we put it away. No. You make a lot of different objects out of it and they come into different collections, right?
Yeah, that also really depends on the type of animal that you collect, but maybe we can go to the next click. Zoological preparation. You will see in the next few minutes that there's, again, like different types of preparations, zoological, paleontological, and so on.
For
but
now, we just
stick to that one.
Now we just speak about how to put away a mammal in a museum. You know, just that everyone knows. If you ever ask yourself how to do that, today we check that.
Click.
Yes.
Preparing mammals.
Yes, okay, yes, please.
Next one. Mm-hmm. Okay, so here. So essentially what happens, for example, if you collect a mammal, or you can do, we have a variety of different collections within the mammal collection, to put it that way. And although I'm not like a mammal collector myself, well, it would be heartbreaking because you have to kill
you're
the
right,
animals.
Yes. So, okay.
But in principle, we have these collections here, and of course, not every time every single individual is taken apart like that, right? But in principle, this is what happens. And
have the skin, you have the skeleton, and you have a skull collection. We visited the skull collection; it's really impressive. Just skulls, a whole big room full of skulls,
really?
And it was just one of the rooms. And then there are, of course, organ prepared organs and tissue samples, and then you also put something in the gene bank, right?
Yeah, nowadays, what is important, that's why we have the tissue samples also, mm-hmm. is that you want to actually preserve organs or tissues for DNA studies.
Yes.
And also, then, in addition, if you already extracted DNA, you also kind of... Well, that's just files in a computer, right? But then the DNA is also being stored somehow.
Okay.
And and then you have histological preparation. Although the storage of the DNA is, getting back to that, that is usually something that can either be done, I'm not perfectly sure here if that is also being done just here or if we just upload that somewhere publicly, because there's also public databases for genes, online databases.
Yeah, public, open access.
Yes, of course, open
access. That's great, very good.
But tissue samples is something that we certainly do, mm-hmm. because in the old days, when we put something, and this is what we did, I just noticed we didn't really cover that here. We also have wet collections, also in the mammal collection. Wet collections are specimens in alcohol.
The whole specimen in alcohol,
The whole specimen in alcohol, right?
Do you still do that today?
Of course, yeah.
Depending on forever.
On what you want to... I mean, again, you would probably... It really depends what you want to do with the mammals and summer, but I can imagine that you still would put also water today. You would put mammals in jars with alcohol. I mean, you do that certainly with amphibians and reptiles, which is where I come from mostly, and that's mostly what you do. Okay. But the problem, the reason I'm saying that now, the tissue samples are necessary because alcohol, or in the old days, formaldehyde, all kinds of other types of preservatives, they destroy the DNA.
Let's be honest, alcohol still destroys a lot of stuff. Today.
Exactly. And for these reasons, you normally, when you, for example, collect a specimen in the field, we call it euphemistically collect, right? Essentially, you put it down, it's dead. You take, for example, a piece of liver and put it and put that one elsewhere, and that is being used for DNA later because the preservatives will destroy the DNA.
I see. So it looks very complicated.
It is.
So, and what is a histological preparation? What is that?
Oh, that is basically you slice it up and make histological slices out of it.
Slices.
This is not often. Well, we still do it here, but it was. But we also have some really very, very important and very historically meaningful histological collections from like a century ago or earlier. We also acquired stuff from other museums which for some reason. No longer wanted to have them, so we took them. So we have a very, very good histological collection.
Oh, interesting. I haven't seen that one yet.
Yeah. It's just like, looks like the, you know, the old days when we had diapositives, like slides, like present your holidays, you know. And it's like that, you know, it's like magazines like this with like slides.
You know. One day I will check it out. So, but if you think it's just the mammals that are so complicated, don't worry. Of course, they do that with a lot of different species. Let's go to the next, please.
No.
Doch.
I wanted to talk about the cats.
The cats? No, we can. Oh, Philip, didn't I tell you? Well, we speak later about the cats.
We do speak about the
cats? We speak about little
If you cats. Want, there's always a cat.
Oh, there's my always, God. There's, of course. Can you imagine a show without a cat within?
I don't know anything of this. Is new. This surprises me.
Yeah, it makes me sad. So you need to listen. No, please go on. And we're nearly there with the cats.
Okay,
so please, one click.
See.
Yeah, this is me in front of one of these big closets for the skins, as you can see, and it's just one. I mean, they have
plenty.
They have plenty. Yeah, plenty is well said. Actually, it's really impressive if you open just one and then you open the other and you think it looks all the same, and they're no, they are very, very different. And different ages, and it's very. You even have research here at the house. I know that from Stefan Bock about how to preserve them and how to.
Of course, it's an important issue because they also deteriorate. I mean, essentially, it's former living tissue that is now dead, and as you know, death also means
decay. Yes, exactly. We have a question. Another one.
Read it with the weird voice for me, please.
No, I will not. I will not read it with a weird voice. Okay. Is there also the subject mummification in taxidermy?
Ooh, that's a good question. I mean, we have some examples later, maybe, that could
that are a little
kind
bit close
of
to that.
Go
yeah.
into that direction.
And yeah, it's a subject. And you know what? The taxidermist, we had her here yesterday. And Christine, we really miss you.
That's what I said.
Greetings to Christine. Goodness. But we will answer this question on our blog, glitzerndenken.blog, and we will answer this question in English. But I will translate that no one gets a panic attack I will do that.
I would say in some ways, of course, there is some type of mummification because you have to make the skin, for example, you have to preserve the skin somehow.
Yes.
There are certain techniques that are necessary that are probably in some way similar to mummification, although I'm not perfectly sure about the techniques like the ancient Egyptians used and how that compares to what we do today. But there is a point here.
There is a point here. Yeah. Thank you for these questions. The rest of the answer we give you on the blog. Let's go one click more, please. Yes, because if you thought it's difficult to prepare a mammal, no, it's not just the mammals. It's difficult with all of these beings. So preparing birds, we thought about, let's see.
Birds also have a variety of different, or we have quite some different collections of birds.
Yeah. You know? I'm sorry. Yes, so this is the bird collection where you see really the stuffed birds, from the 19th century. Funny thing about that is they all look in the same direction.
So we have these rules here. I mean, also if you go to the alcohol exhibition here, like where you see all the animals in alcohol,
they also look in the same direction.
There is a certain way of how we put the snakes into the jars.
Of course you have.
No, there is. I mean, so they all look the same when you look it up. Like the way they are basically curled up, it's always the same.
To really make sure, do you see this beauty here? How do you say that in English?
Otter.
It's an otter. Yeah. Okay.
That's an otter.
You also look in the same direction. Very 19th century, right? Very good. Looks very good. So, and all the birds, even the skeletons, do one click more. Even the skeletons all look in the same direction. It's really, really funny if you go through it. And it's also impressive. They don't do that today anymore.
No.
But, this is how you can see that this parrot up there is just, it's really just a puppet. It's not, you know, an object here at the museum. No, because he looks in the wrong direction. Very clear. I mean, come on. So, let's go on, please. Yes. So, and then we have, and I think that's so funny. You know, for birds, you have a wing collection, you have a feather collection, and they explained to me it's a little bit like with stamps. Really, it looks like a stamp collection, the feather collection. And they have a syrinx collection. Syrinx is this singing apparatus of birds. They just have a collection for these. They have an eye collection, a hyoid bone collection, a chest bone collection, and even a stomach collection.
Well, there's important reasons why you want to have those collections.
Yes, why?
For comparison.
The syrinx, for comparison. Did you say comparison?
Yes, I did.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly the point. The syrinx collection we are one of the few museums, I think, who have a decent syrinx collection. I mean, the bird vocal organ, you know.
Yes.
Of course, also, most of these specimens are old because it was in the olden days where people really did comparative morphology and decided to have these individual collections. And I think nowadays we think more about, I don't know, for example, computer tomography, which we'll see later and stuff. Mm-hmm. In many ways, we often don't do that anymore because we think we don't need it, but it's still cool to have them, actually. And sometimes it's really... What do you mean? Why is that so funny?
That's very funny, but it's actually cool to have them. Sure. Who else wants to have a wing collection? You know, I dreamt...
It happened to me with a colleague of mine from Austin, Texas, and she was here for a while for a sabbatical, and she's a bird person, and we were thinking about...
A bird person.
Well, she's a paleoornithologist, and she together with me were thinking about vocalization in vertebrates and also in reptiles and lizards and so on, and for that reason we still have this project in our minds where we want to compare the bird vocal organ to other reptile not syrinxes but larynxes. Which is why we also did some work on the turtle larynx, for example.
If you do that, can I come along and say something about the human larynx?
Yeah, maybe.
Let's see whether there are connections to singing or whatever.
Prior to the pandemic, we went through our collection to look to check how many syrinxes we have here.
And you figured out a lot.
We can try to copy their noises.
Yes, and we could see how you produce the sound if you are a bird or if you are a human or if you are an elk.
An elk. Interesting, yeah.
Yeah, I would like to know how an elk does his sounds.
She also found the oldest syrinx.
No.
Ooh.
In the collection.
A fossil syrinx from the Cretaceous of Antarctica.
How old is it?
In the late Cretaceous, meaning, I don't know, 70 million, 75, 80 million, I don't know, something.
Okay,
birds already existed at the time, so they must have had a syrinx. But we didn't really know until we saw one fossilized, and she found that one when she was on an expedition in Antarctica.
Wow, so even 70 million years ago?
Or probably even more.
Yeah, the birds made some noise.
Yes, I would personally say this is probably even older, but I mean, it was not clear because we're talking too much about that, I noticed. But they don't ossify, you know, their cartilaginous, usually.
What do they do? Excuse me.
Knorpelis in German. And if they're cartilaginous, then they don't fossilize well. So this is why we don't find syrinxes that often. You must have very special conditions so that you would actually have something like this preserved in the fossil record.
Like the Arctis.
Like they were where they went and they were just lucky, but of course kind of had an idea we find cool stuff there if you go there and the weather is good, which it wasn't mostly. But but they were successful.
Oh, nice. Yeah, are we also talking about the cat?
Soon, but here I would like to thank Jan Panninger for all these informations, and he even told me about a feather thief who...
Yeah, I love that story.
Yeah, who stole...
He got caught here, right?
Yeah, he caught here in Berlin, so I don't know whether here in the house, but he was caught here in Berlin, so he went to collections and was like, I'm expert for birds, and the Swiss feather thief. And he went to the collections and people trusted him to check the bird, and someone here in Berlin figured out, this bird had more feathers before.
Oh, we also have people who go for our rhino horns because there's so much money in them.
What?
No.
Because rhinos are going extinct in the wild, so they were thinking, the museums have rhino horns. And each horn, I think, has like 50,000 euros or something. I mean...
This is unacceptable, and this is stupid. Market, so you know, this guy, yeah. I think he really got to prison for that. So
how did you get this out of the museum? Like,
yeah, so...
There have been other museums in Europe, like more than 10, where they really went in there violently.
Ah, okay.
You know, and broke in and basically took the rhino horns. You know?
Well, I just always see myself stealing a horn, and I'm like, with my shoes, I'm going to be like, hi.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I ask to focus? Because I get the trouble with the time again. Yes, thank you. How did we got there? Oh, my goodness. Let's go on, because there's more stuff to prep. You know, let's go on.
The next
click.
Yeah?
Yes.
Entomological preparation, we spoke about that last year. It was great, but we do not talk about that today. It's prepping insects, basically. And yes, there is a technique and there's a tradition and it's, yeah.
It's different from the rest.
I read emotional preparations, no?
Yeah, I mean, we always do that every day. Not always does that work. Okay, let's go on.
This word, I know it.
Well, I didn't know that before I met you. I mean, that this thing exists. Paleontological preparation.
Of course, I mean, the people at least here in the audience can see that bone here on the.
Oh, they can also in the cameras.
Really?
Can
okay.
see that yeah. bone there. This is really a dinosaur bone.
Yeah, this is a dinosaur bone. That is, of course, prepared. You would not find that bone in such a condition normally in the field. I mean, you find it in a piece of rock, there's dirt around it, it's broken. There's all kinds of things you need to do when you want to collect such a bone.
Okay.
In the field, so that's already the preparation. So there's all, so I know we don't have much time, right? So I have to be careful. But in principle, when you find, for example, I mean, there's all kinds of different paleo preparation because it depends on if you want to find like invertebrates, like little snails or mussels, bivalves, mm-hmm. I mean, like mussels and stuff. Like if you want to collect those, it's different from if you want to collect a dinosaur bone, right? So, and there's different types of preparation, but certainly you have to prepare the stuff so that you can study it.
You and me wrote that down. It's called, there is the mechanical preparation,
okay.
and you have tools like dentists have.
Yeah, like little jackhammers, actually even cooler stuff.
Of course, they have the cooler tools.
Yeah, like, can you just,
mm-hmm. yeah. Okay, and then
you can also destroy a lot if you're not really well skilled, like.
How good are you? In this?
I'm terrible.
I
did use the jackhammer when I was younger, but once I actually got a tendonitis here because I had a wrong posture when I was doing something.
I think musicians can relate to that, yeah? That wrong posture can be a painful thing.
And then I chipped off a bone from the specimen. It went all the way through the room, and it was like this small, and it was really annoying. So we basically brushed the floor, and then took all the dirt and took a microscope and then searched through the dirt.
Wow.
And then we found the bone again and glued it back.
And since then you have people who do
then
that
I stopped,
for you.
You know, actually I was like, no, it's not my thing.
We love gluing things back on.
Yeah.
Okay, but you also told me that there is an acid preparation.
Sometimes when you have specimens that are, where you know that, for example, the specimens themselves have a lot of calcium carbonate,
mm-hmm.
Like, for example, corals,
mm-hmm.
yeah. And the surrounding matrix is not, it doesn't contain as much calcium carbonate, mm-hmm. Then you basically can use acid, if you're careful, and basically make the other way around, sorry, I was making it up. So you basically use it to dissolve the calcium carbonate. And sometimes the surrounding matrix has more of it than the fossil, and if that's the case, then you can use acid, and then actually everything else gets dissolved, and then you have the beautiful fossil without any mechanical preparation.
Great.
Unless you forget it in the bucket.
Then you can forget the fossil. Then you can forget
yeah,
the fossil.
Exactly. Yeah.
If you forget it, it's like with cooking. Did we miss something about the paleontological preparation?
Or there's another one.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah. There's all, chemical preparation also exists in other ways, like with.
Do we need it?
No, we don't need it.
Right now. Yeah. But there are different ways and it's complicated and there are, of course, experts for that. And Johannes already told us his story why he has other fields of expertise. So, great. But you also said that this work is done in the field. And if,
Half-half, or maybe not half-half, but a lot of it is being done in the field because you have to get, like, such a dinosaur bone out of the field in the first place.
Yeah.
And what you do there, you do some sort of a first-time preparation.
Yes.
And that I can do too. You know, this is like
what I'm
capable of. So sometimes the bones, for example, are very, I mean, they look fossilized and like rocks, they are.
Mm-hmm.
But they're still very fragile.
Yes.
So they can, like, they're very crumbly and very, so if you lift the specimen, the bone, like for example, you, take all the dirt away, and then you basically want to lift it somehow, and then it would actually fall apart in that moment.
It's an emotional preparation, as
exactly.
I said.
So there's there's various types of things you have to do in the field.
Yeah.
Yeah. First, you glue it, like with a very, very liquid kind of glue.
They glue dinosaur bones.
It's a special
bones.
Type of super glue,
yeah.
you know,
super
and you
glue.
Have different components that you mix in the field only.
Yeah.
And then you get like have a bottle full of that glue, and then basically, when you have a large specimen, you often pour it over the entire specimen many times.
Yes.
It's and that it hardens quickly, especially when you're like somewhere in the tropics and in the desert, and then you take make a plaster jacket, like plaster, like when your arm is broken, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and you create a cap of plaster around yes. the specimen. And then you basically continue digging like underneath until you have some sort of you hollow it out, and then you have the bone here with a jacket or the plaster cap.
Yes.
And then you hollow it out, and then you take a big iron bar, and then you basically just flip it over. Then you close yes. up the underside, also again with plaster, and then you have this beautiful plaster jacket, and then that actually is really stable normally, yeah, and then you can.
If I would have known that this is so complicated, then we take 5 minutes for that.
Oh, yeah. Anyways, I stop now.
No, but this is how we get done? Is it already the field. Is it already done, or is some step left missed?
No, then you carry it to the lab here in Berlin, and then the paleo prep people do the real work.
The real work. Yeah. Okay. that was not the real work, guys. Thank you for that insight. Okay. That's amazing. Okay. Yeah, let's go to the subject with the cats. Philip, please. Of course, here at the Natural History Museum, we have taxidermists, great taxidermists, some of the best here in Germany, and they are amazing people. And taxidermy is a very interesting field. And it has a long tradition, also in Europe. And it wasn't as, I mean, when you go through the museum, you see beautiful, beautiful
artwork.
Objects.
It's really artwork,
art
guys.
What they do, absolutely. But let's see, it wasn't always like that. This is what a cat looked like in the, it's an ocelot, and it's from the 18th century. It's from the 18th century, and we had Christine Scheinflug here, and she was not, let's say she was not satisfied with that work.
But also she said that they really tried their best to actually do it.
Yes.
But it looked that way because they didn't have enough information on those animals, so they kind of all looked confused.
Do you remember why they didn't have the information?
There's no internet.
This is what it looks like when you have no internet. Yes. So, but in the 19th century, they kind of did their research and they practiced a little bit, so this is what it looks like. Click. Mm. In the 19th century, this is really a beauty, isn't he?
But nevertheless, he was not satisfied with the ears.
Yeah, right. There was still something she criticized. So she, because when Christine Scheinflug does it here in the Museum für Naturkunde, then results look like this. It's a difference, right? Is that the beauty? Yeah. What is the next picture?
Let's see.
Yeah,
and me. This is... That's me.
Yeah, that's you, but this is really a huge cat. And you can see that, so our guests here, if you go this way, and on the left side, the para exhibition, there you also have this beauty, and I really recommend to check it out, because it's a beautiful, beautiful piece. And it's done here at the Natural History Museum Berlin. It is really amazing. And what you also can see is a form that's impressive here, right? It looks real, it looks vivid, it looks alive, but also that, Christine explained to us, you remember, that was not always the case. I mean, every one of you knows this is a penguin, right? Down here, this is a modern penguin. Yes, of course
there.
We know, but...
Then we have the long-neck penguin.
Yeah, we have some biologists in the audience. Are there long-neck penguins we know of? No? No.
Someone's shaking their head, so obviously no.
No. Well, Christine explained, so what we know with this one, it's, I haven't written that down, but it's from the early 19th century, and I think the guy who collected it he was murdered in 1822. And apart from that, we know nothing about this object.
Yeah, they tried their best.
They tried their best.
What Christine also said is that they... of course, often didn't have any pictures of their living animals. They couldn't just Google it.
Yes. And they didn't know what a penguin looked like. This is what a penguin looks like if you don't have internet. Isn't he a beauty? And she also explained to me that they had to fix it with nails, you know, when they had too much skin on some places, then they just
Tuk, tuk.
You know, what went wrong, they need to fix it somehow. It's still a beauty, and it's really an honor to have it here, because normally, of course, a natural history museum wants to show how it really looks like, yeah, that you learn the truth, and not just the first try. But I think he is a beauty, and I really thank the taxidermists here at the Naturkunde Museum Berlin that we can have this beauty here tonight. Thank you. Yes, yeah, thank you. Then let's go to the next point. Yeah. Of course, there's also with preparation, you know, I mean, you saw how it looks like when they really tell, when they really know their craft, when they really tell life with these objects. It's really beautiful. But of course, people do always also the not serious things, right? They play with things. And they did that in the 19th century, and they do that today. And let's give it a click. And maybe, yeah, here we go also to the mummification, because isn't she a beauty? Do you remember Ariel? This is the first try. Yes? So it's called a Fiji mermaid. And in the 19th century, this was a hype. This was really a thing. And it's made, and I think, of a mummified ape. So the upper part is a mummified ape, and the lower part is a fish. I think it's also a dried fish.
Well, at least looks dry now.
I'm sure it's dry now, absolutely. So we go on, because if you think it's just, okay, one piece, no. There were really stories about it. And I mean, can you imagine that Disney would have made a film out of that one? I don't see that. Well, let's go on, because it was really, you know, it was like center. It's the centerpiece in your living room.
We all have it.
Isn't it? Can you imagine to have that in your home?
No, not like this, but of course, having some prepared stuff, I could imagine.
I could too, but...
Not like this, no.
Not like this. Yeah. I mean, a Fiji mermaid. 19th century, they did a lot of stuff. Anthropomorph taxidermy, where they really tell life and even criticize our society with some...
I mean, I like the posture crazy of the guy in the hat.
Why
the way he's standing there with a hat.
Can you imagine the Fiji mermaid with the hat on? That would look funny.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, but maybe
probably that existed because you said if you can think of it, someone did it.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. That's the thing. But we need to go on because we spoke. It's just the two of us and Philip, and still it's. So this is called a Rasselbock. Of course, it's not real. Come on, it's a. It's a do I say a rabbit here? No.
It's a rabbit or a hare.
Yeah. You know, with horns, but it doesn't exist. It's just a story that originates here in Germany. And Christine Scheinflug told us, well, this is what a taxidermist does if a brother wishes for it for birthday. And then a taxidermist even does unrealistic stuff like a Rasselbock. And then the next picture, you put the next picture in. Yeah,
that's my favorite because it's also fake.
Yes, because it's funny hair. I mean, you can go into the club with that, yeah? Do some good soul music with this. It looks, it's fake, right?
It is not fake. It's actually a disease.
It's a disease.
It's a growth anomaly. So, yeah.
And I think I remember Christine also told us, you know, it can grow over the eyes and it can be very heavy. So it looks cool, but it's cool for the animal. And it's called a peruke hat.
What?
Peruke hat. It's an interesting word for that. But thank you, Johannes.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Philip.
Yes.
Thank you for that,
Venus.
Both of you. Yes, thank you. Now, it's time again for music. And this time, I give the microphone to the head of the orchestra, Misha Tangian. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. The next piece I'm going to introduce is a composition of mine. It's called The Forgotten, and it's also a question of life and death. I've composed it and dedicated it basically to humans of my own kind. I must say I'm originally Russian-Armenian. I have an Armenian grandfather, and this piece reflects on the Armenian genocide that happened about 100 years ago. That's the title, The Forgotten, because we like to forget things. And the version we're going to play today is a very special one, because we invited a singer, Rebal Al-Hudari. He's a very special singer here from Syria, who is going to improvise on this piece instead of the duduk, which usually plays that part. And I don't know if you know the duduk, which is an Armenian traditional instrument made out of apricot tree wood. And Rebal is replacing the duduk today. He's going to be our apricot tree. So, The Forgotten, with a text which is also very interesting, because it's a text we chose based on the question of why we humans as creatures try not only to kill animals and talk about animals and talk about how to eat animals and prepare animals, but we also like to do things to humans, like making our own lives shorter, other people's lives shorter. And in this case, it was a Sudanese writer, Abdel Wahab Yusuf, who as a young man escaped from Sudan of war because he wanted a safe life. So he changed his location and was trying to escape through the Mediterranean Sea, where he unfortunately drowned, not even 30 years old. And this text is one of the last texts he wrote. It's saying basically like a prophecy what's going to happen to him. And it starts with the words, you'll die at sea. So we're going to perform this now with the text. Rebal is going to improvise. And we're going to play.
Yeah. ليس سيئا أن تغادر باكرا أبدا في مقتبل العمر ليس سيئا أن تغادر باكرا أبدا السيء أن تموت وحيدا دون امرأة السيء أن تموت وحيدا دون امرأة أن تموت
gentlemen, Reval Alkodari and the Babylon Orchestra. Thank you. Thank you, Reval. Our last round, and we have 4 minutes. We can do that. So, whatever. It's the last evening, so let's just give it a go. Let's speak about about research results. You research, if I remember right, the developing of the hearing organs, of the hearing senses. Would you please like give us a one click? Yeah, I mean, that you can play like this and sing like that. You need to have good ears. You need to have good ears. And these ears are developed a little bit before humans came on this earth.
Well, yeah, that's true. So some of the stuff that we've been doing in our lab over the past 10 years, a little more, was actually the evolution of like sensory evolution in general.
Yes.
Vision and hearing. And hearing was one of our topics, especially, well, it was a PhD thesis, for example, done mm-hmm. by Gabriela Sobral, who is now in Stuttgart. Mm-hmm. And she did that work, what you see here. Well, this was part of it.
Yes.
She looked into the hearing in dinosaurs. She was the only real dinosaur fan in our lab so far.
Okay.
I admit I'm not the greatest fan.
No? Oh, they're so cute.
They're big and heavy.
They're big and...
Really yes. annoying when you want to collect them. But anyway, so...
always practical thinking.
So what you see, but she really loves them. And so she wanted to work on those. And so what you see here is the brain case. The fossilized brain case of one of the dinosaurs that you see also in the dinosaur hall, Dicelotosaurus, mm-hmm. A small little herbivore.
He's cute, yeah. Like this high.
And this is the same that you saw on the previous slide. I mean, this is a computer tomography image. So this is we have an X-ray computer tomography machine here in the museum, or actually I have two. And with that, we can generate these digital 3D objects or images of, for example, that dinosaur brain case. And what Gabi did at the time, she was looking into the evolution of the inner ear
yes.
in dinosaurs. And the inner ear, like our inner ear as well, is made up of so-called semicircular canals. We have them too in our inner ear. And this is what you see here in orange and green.
Okay.
So there's there's always like three semicircular canals. You see two of them here. And they are in a different orientation. And on the one hand, they are important for hearing.
Yes.
And on the other hand, they're also important for balance. So, which is why when you basically spin around your own axis too fast, you know, you get dizzy.
You get dizzy. So dinosaurs already got dizzy.
Yeah, because of the liquids
I have three questions for that one.
Yeah.
So when did it develop?
Well, it evolved, you mean, what do you mean?
When did it evolve?
In dinosaurs or?
Yeah, well, on
Earth. Or generally?
Could we say generally? Yeah?
Yeah, well, that was actually one side project, but we have the more beautiful images here. So this is why we show those, right? So
well, this show, it's okay.
Hearing itself evolved, I mean, impedance matching hearing, like modern acoustic hearing, as we know it, in vertebrates, evolved way earlier, already like at about 290 million years ago at the latest.
Okay.
And dinosaurs only showed up like 200 million years ago or something. So it happened way earlier in a different group of reptiles.
And do we know why it developed?
You can speculate a bit about that, but we assume that it was because, well, life was proliferating on land. Previously, it was mm-hmm. all in the water, right? So
yes.
more niches, ecological niches, were being filled.
Yes.
And probably some animals then turned nocturnal, meaning being active at night. Previously, that was probably not really the big fashion, you know. But later on, this evolved because species were competing for niche space, evolutionarily speaking. And some of them probably turned active at night, and that usually requires very good vision and very good hearing. You see this nowadays in owls, for example, or cats.
So if I'm not an early...
Which have the best hearing and vision
sure,
senses in among mammals.
So if you're not an early bird, you have a chance of really good ears.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, that's great. Thank you for that. Let's go to the next point. And let's, you know what, for the last two... let's go to the center again.
Okay.
You and me. Badger burrows. Because it's really funny what we learned about badger burrows. This is something you right now... work again.
This is something we want to develop.
Yeah,
I mean, it's one of the things. It sounds a bit weird because badger burrows, I mean, badgers. You know, I'm not really a badger expert at all. But we have here, and I think this is what I should say, you know, 100 years ago, the museum here in Berlin performed this big excavation campaign in today, what is today, Tanzania. This is why there's the dinosaurs here and so on. At about 50 years ago, the second largest paleontological excavation campaign occurred in what is today Mecklenburg-Vorpommern, near the Müritz, Lake Müritz, near Malchin.
Okay.
And there we have a burrow system primarily constructed by badgers that was developed or established shortly after the last ice age was over, or when the glaciers actually had melted.
So it's more than 10,000 years old?
More than 10,000 years old.
No!
And they're still active there, so there's still an active burrow system, but they accumulated millions and millions of bones over those millennia.
And we need to tell people the fun fact about badgers. Because, you know, a badger, if he clutters his place or her place, they do not clean up, they don't clean out, they just move.
Yeah, so they filled up their chambers and their burrows and so on, and with bones and, I don't know, rubbish of some sort that now is deteriorated, you know. And then when this all was all filled up, they just basically, yeah, translocated.
Since 10,000 years.
Relocated to like a few meters left or right, depending on.
So it means there is a lot of stuff going on there.
But why is there frog bones inside?
This is what we see here.
Yeah, there's a drawer full of frog bones, for example.
That you pulled out there.
Yes, badgers, they're omnivorous, meaning they eat pretty much anything that fits into their mouth. I mean, they don't like plants, but when it comes to meat, you know? And so they would actually go after amphibians, reptiles, small mammals, and so on. And then those bones would end up in the burrow system.
And then, so you already dig them up, and now you have them here, and you think, let's look at them again. And if you think, you know, I mean, can you imagine measuring all of these little bones?
Well, you basically sieve it, right? You take the sediment and you sieve it with different types of sieves.
Yeah, but if you measure them and
poop, be careful.
Oh, yeah, and then you have some minions who actually,
collect can see
the
bones. Them later.
Yes. Mm.
It looks like a lot of work, actually. I wish you most of luck with that, and much fun. And then we have turtles and.
Well, I have to say something. Why are we doing this?
Yes, please.
Sorry that I have
to
say.
Do that. Yeah, right? You have to.
We're not doing that for the sake of badger burrow system. And but the reason is this is the best site in continental Europe that can tell us something about how modern biodiversity reassembled after the last ice age.
Oh.
So basically, this tells us something about environmental change, even human influence, when humans also started settling here, and how the fauna actually responded to this, and how fast.
Wow.
So there is all kind. This is actually quite an important question when you look at what is happening nowadays, Anthropocene and so on. So this is why we're doing this.
So it's great that you can research.
To add that.
It's great that you can research because they did not clean up their place.
Exactly, and I sympathize with.
Me too, absolutely. So that's great. And now the last thing, turtles and climate change. Because you, Johannes, told me that with a friend of yours and another scientist from Cambridge, the two of you wrote a paper. And
Not just the two of us, actually it was Jason Head, my friend and colleague from Cambridge, and especially his highly talented, now former PhD student, Abigail Parker, who has been doing this work.
And you checked turtles. What did you figure out in this paper?
It's in review at the moment. So basically what we tried to do was to check, simply speaking, can we use turtle shells to predict climate?
Yes.
And this is because we know that there's a correlation between temperature and the size distribution of turtles across the world. So this had been established previously.
Yes.
And so here we were wondering, can we basically do it the other way around? Basically taking, for example, a size distribution of turtles and of a community of turtles, and then basically say something about climate, about the environmental conditions.
Does it work?
We were hoping for more resolution. but at the same time, I want to say, we're not just doing this because we're like turtle geeks, which we are. but the reason is, if you have a well-established relationship between environmental conditions and a so-called functional trait in an animal, then you can use that and look for anomalies.
Okay.
So for example, we could ideally, and this is what we're still kind of hoping for in the future, maybe in some, at some point, you could take that and together with some other traits from other animals, yes, like mammals, and look for areas where you would actually expect something different. Mm-hmm. Because you have already established that relationship. And for example, if humans screw up a certain area, you might actually see an anomaly that you can see with those animals, by using those animals. Even if you would not be able to see that at first sight yourself, all of a sudden you analyze, you model it, and you see weaknesses or anomalies in certain areas. And this is why we're doing this, because this way we can basically, hopefully, look at the influence of humans, for example, on biodiversity and how that actually screws up ecosystems.
And didn't you say that it's not enough data because maybe humans, as you said, we screwed up some environments, yes?
Well, if it's already screwed up in the first place, then it's difficult to establish that relationship,
yes,
right? But so there's different reasons why we're not sure why this didn't work that well. Of course, one of the reasons could be that what we see nowadays among turtles in the world is not what you would normally expect to see. So many of you probably know the giant tortoises from the Galapagos Islands and,
yes,
the Seychelles and the Indian Ocean. But normally we would have similar sized tortoises also on continents.
Aww.
And that actually was the case until a few, I don't know, 10,000 years ago.
Just a few years.
Not that long ago, to be honest, in some way. And this already has changed, probably thanks to us. And the question is if that actually affects our analysis, which we're not sure
about. So our behavior with nature, how we treat nature, even destroys the database for figuring out what we are doing wrong. This is really problematic. But I wish for you a lot of success and all of you a lot of fun still doing this work and figuring out all the stuff we all need to know to change our world and make it better for environment and for all of us. Thank you, Johannes Müller.
Thank you as well.
And at this point, we are at the end of the show already. It feels so short. May I ask for my stand? Lima, thank you. Our last song with the Babylon Orchestra is Desert Rose from Sting. No stand. Okay. And Rebal, we need Rebal. Where is he? Oh, Rebal. Can we... Last applause for Rebal Akudari. Yeah.
Yeah, today we all take our stance ourselves, you know. Self service.
Ayo!
I dream of gardens in the deserts. innocent. I wake in vain, lay, lay. I dream of love as time runs through my hand. I dream of rain, lay, lay. I lift my gaze to the empty skies above. I close my eyes, the rare perfume is the sweet intoxication of love.
This happening here. And first of all, we need to thank the people who gave us the funding for this project. It's the Lotto Stiftung Berlin, and we worked together with Wissenschaft in Dialog. It was a great collaboration. Thank you. And of course, this beautiful museum. Everyone here is amazing, you know, from the general director to the security staff, and of course, the collection managers, the scientists, the experts, the taxidermists, the administration, everyone here is amazing and was very, very welcoming. Thank you for that. Thank you, Museum für Naturkunde, for this. Then, a project like this could not happen without a lot of really skilled technicians. We have here, and I ask for an applause for them, from Citizen Five, Björn, Paul, Pavel, Tim, and for the orchestra, Marianne. Thank all of you for your work. It's great. Thank you. And then, yeah. So we brought our whole team from the Ensemble Salon Fisch here to create with the museum this show. And yes, we also brought our own light technician and light designer, and without him and his help, we couldn't have done such a complex thing. So thank you from all of my heart. Stefan Tietz. Then, at this point, you might get the idea how complex a project like this is. We of course have people here at the museum who organize everything, when someone needs to be, who needs to be where, who needs to speak with whom. We have for this, and I really ask for a big applause for them, because tonight is the last night, Bonnie Dietermann and her team, Paluca Frank, David Ziegler, Vivian and Lona. Thank you! Hi, girl! Yeah! Thank you for that. They really deserve it. They did a lot, great work here. So, and then you saw, without an expert, what can you do in a show like this? So, ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Professor Dr. Johannes Müller. And then I introduced him as my plus one, but of course he's much, much more. Thank you, Philip, for the whole event and the whole work together. It's really a pleasure to have you here and have you around. Ladies and gentlemen, Philip Gollitz! And with him, Jillian Charlene Schnack! Come on, yeah, our beautiful dancer, Jillian Charlene Schnack. Thank you, Jillian. And then there, I mean, we all enjoyed them tonight, right? Ladies and gentlemen, please, give it up for the Babylon Orchestra with its orchestra leader, Misha Tankian, and the great singer, Rebel Alkodari. Bravi.
I'm going to introduce also the band. Our wonderful ney player, Valentina Belanova.
Yeah. Yes.
And on the kamanche from Iran, Farhang Moshta.
Bravo.
And on the cello, Basilio Salawat.
Bravo.
On the electric bass, or Rosenfeld.
Bravo!
And on percussion, Peter Kunsch. On the oud, Alla Suiten.
Ayo, bravi!
On the viola, Ksenia Zadorska.
Woo! Brava!
She just arrived from Ukraine 2 weeks ago.
Yeah. Welcome.
We have Azin Zahidi on santur and flute.
Woo! Brava!
So, the Babylon Orchestra. And I give the word to Alla Suiten Zut.
I need you, sorry. Just for one last time, I would like to say thank all of you that you were here, that you are here with us. Tell the world about this project. We will love to continue it and see you again. And for now, it's time for me to say thank you. My name is Ines Teileis. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
stage. Come on, please. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Wir haben Zugabe gehört. Wir dürfen noch eine Zugabe geben. Oh, well, if you say, encore, we prepared something, if you like. Thank you. We really love to play. So, ladies and gentlemen, for the last time here, now, Strange Museum. Hiya.
Come on in, and set me free. We won't refuse those who wanna see. It's a strange museum. So bring your loved ones, those you hold dear. Bring them all, there's no restriction here. It's a strange museum. Blame as an easy escape. There's nothing on show that is about shame. It's not about shame.
Ihr könnt von der Bühne, ihr könnt runter.